Do you have any examples to Russia, to Angola?
For example, Angola, I don't remember when we met them, but their kind of handball is just, you know, I don't think they know what they are doing, because we don't know what they do. It's just, you know, the intuition, and they're just doing things. Where in Denmark we are a bit more like structure, and we have these systems, and we have something we do. There's some who is thinking more systems and like that everything is going like this, bum bum bum, and we know exactly what we do. And then there's Jesper, for example, who is also like systems, but he also wants us to look at the situation and in the situation think, okay, what is best now? Is it best that I go and play, or I stay back and go? So you get so much from playing handball, because you are in a team, you have to cooperate with your teammates, and in Denmark you really appreciate it.
Hey Mette.
Hey.
Who are you?
Well, that's a big question. I'm from Aarhus. I've lived there all my life, besides when I moved to Odense and now Esbjerg. I have played handball since I was 8, so handball has been a big part of my life. Mm. I like sports. I like explore the body, and I have educated myself to physiotherapist. Mm. So I like this kind of the world where you going into the body and how can you move and what can you do with it and nutritions and something like that. Mm-hmm. So that's also good when you play handball to know something about the body, so you can be most prepared for the games and do the best for your presentation and your things.
When does it start that you're so interested into the body, into the movements, into the physics? When does it start?
I've actually always liked to play. When I was little, I liked to play football, to play handball, to play every kind of sports. So it actually started pretty early. And then when I went to, the school is called Folkeskolen in Denmark. I liked biology and mathematics, and I always liked those kind of science. And then I saw that you could get physiotherapist, and I thought I'd try it, and it was fun.
Okay, but did you make the education beside handball? So you stop your school, you finish your school,
yep.
And then you make these physiotherapist education beside that. How was that possible? Is it a normal connection way here in Denmark?
The education system is good to handle people in elite sports. They are aware that we have a lot to do besides our education, so they can help us to move exams or help us to get to follow the others when we don't have so much time. Mm-hmm. So I have the education is normally 3.5 years, and I have done it in 5 years, so I have just stretched it over more time, and that was fine.
Okay, perfect. Why did you start playing handball?
My parents always said you have to do something besides school. You have to, if it's something physical or anything you like, you just have to do something within your hobby. Mm-hmm. And then some of the girls from my school, they were playing handball, and then I thought I'll try it. Mm-hmm. And then I thought it was fun. I actually started as a goalkeeper because they saw that I had a big size, so I couldn't go to the corners. but then they found out I was left-handed, and then I got out. So
how many practice did they?
Yeah, actually, pretty much, because they also thought I was a good goalkeeper, so it was difficult for them.
Okay, did you visit a specific sports school?
No.
No.
I was considering after the first 9 years of my school to go to an after school, is it called in Denmark? Mm-hmm. Where you could play handball and go to school, both things at the time. But I was happy in Aarhus, where I lived, and the team I was in was good, and we were developing very good, so I decided to stay.
So it wasn't necessary for your development as a handball player?
No, I was looking forward to go to the senior team very soon, so I thought it was better to stay to get that possibility instead of going to a sports school.
Would you think that is normal, or that it happened quite often that like elite player like you got the situation playing on the highest level without going to the sports school, into the after school? Is it?
Yeah, I actually think it's pretty normal. Mm-hmm. But there's more and more, I think, who's going to the sports school, because there's also a lot of social things in it, because it's very nice. I actually now a little bit regret that I didn't go, because I've heard all the fantastic stories about how it is to go there. So I would, if I could do something to change, I would go. But I think there's still a lot who is just going, staying where they play and going the normal way.
How was the normal way in the federation for you? When was the first time that you were getting selected?
I think it was when I played under 16. There was something called talent training, where we were gathered in the, you know, area where I come from. They gathered, and then also in the north and in the south, and we were all over the the land, and then they just gathered us to train with the best players in our area, our local area, and it was fine. It was hard, and it was a bit, in the beginning I felt it was a bit, you know, hard to go and don't know anybody and just go and train, and it was a bit hard, but I found the way and thought it was fun, because there was a lot of players very good, so it was fine.
Okay, how often did you come together in this group in the selected region?
I think it was once a month, every second month or something like that.
For one weekend or?
Yeah, 3 days.
Okay. Okay, like the normal camp situation with the federation.
Yeah, it's a week. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
How was the situation with the coaches there? Was it a coach from another club? Or was it from the federation?
From the federation. It was, they were hired to, you know, develop young people. I think they had some education in that direction.
So it wasn't from another club, so not your coach from an opening team or something like that?
No, it was only for this developing team, yeah.
What was the next step in the selection? So right now we are in the region, one kind of Denmark.
Yeah. It became, I think it was under 17, so no, it's called under 18. Mm-hmm. So then it got the national team, the youth national team, and then it was all Denmark gathered. And then it also went to be a week when we were together. So in the beginning there was a lot of focus on developing, and of course there also was later when we got to the national teams in the youth category, but in the beginning it was only training and no matches, but then when we got to the under 18 it was also matches, and it was a bit more about winning also. First it was only development, and then it also was this winning mentality to be ready to win games
for the competition on the highest level.
Yeah, exactly.
What was how was the experience in the first international tournament?
It was huge. It was really, really, I was very nervous, and everything was just, I thought I was trying just to enjoy it, but you know, you get nervous when it's the first national game. But it was fun, and it was very fun to try to play against other cultures, you know. When we met Russia and we met Angola, it was two different kinds of playing, and that was very nice to, in that age already there, try to see how different it can be from the Danish way to do it.
Do you have any examples to Russia, to Angola?
For example, Angola, I don't remember when we met them, but their kind of handball is just, you know, I don't think they know what they are doing, because we don't know what they do. It's just, you know, their intuition, and they're just doing things. Where in Denmark we had a bit more like structure, and we have these systems, and we have something we do. Where Angola and also Brazil sometimes, and those kind of countries, they are more, you know, just doing something and going in one against one and doing something and hoping that someone will catch the ball when I play. And that was fun to try because we were used to these systems. Mm-hmm. So it was very also very developing for us to try to meet someone who's just playing and not thinking so much. Mm-hmm.
Did you grab some things from the experience for your game?
Yeah, I think actually either if it's in my mind or something that's just mm-hmm. coming, I think when I play against teams where they do something else, I'm trying to take the best things with me. Mm-hmm. But there's also the limit that I can't just go one against one and just win every time. Angola is very good at that, and France is very good at that. Mm-hmm. So they play after their way. So I think I am trying to take the some parts that can fit into my kind and our kind of way of playing, but still we can't just do everything you do because there's a reason they do and we don't do, because they have some different kind of players than we have.
They have a different development from the youth.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm.
What would you say describe the Danish way? So what are typical things you hear like the last 10 years from your coaches? So what are the typical phrases for Danish handball?
I think a huge thing in Danish handball is that we are very doing these systems. There's not so much just go one against one play. Mm-hmm. It's all these systems, and that's also good because then everybody know what's going to do, and if you're good at doing it, then you can score after it. And it's much. We have big players like me, so we want players like me to shoot and get the defense out, so the line player is going to be free, and the small players can go one against one when we have got the defense a bit forward. So that's pretty much what I think the Danish way is, that the big players have to shoot and get the defense forward, and the small players, after we have done that, they can go one against one and play with the line.
Mm-hmm. What would you say? Would you like to add to your game right now? One thing would you say, okay, we play against Mets or we play against them on the Champions League, I miss these thing. What would you wish when here on the table is everything you need and you can pick one skill from handball?
For me personally?
For you personally.
Okay. I would like the speed in one against one.
Yeah?
Because I often get the defense mm-hmm. forward, and if they just think they can get forward and then I play because I want to shoot and I can when they get mm-hmm. forward, then I would like to go, you know, they get forward and just go
against
through.
Them.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So that's, I'm working on it.
Okay, perfect. What would you say, how many coaches work with you in all your different steps, all together, what would you say?
In all my career or just now?
No, on your
how many trainers I have had?
Yeah,
coaches.
What would you think?
Oh, that's a good question. 20 maybe?
A lot of?
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Because I both have the club coaches from all my clubs, mm-hmm. and then I have the national team, both youth and senior, and I think it's about 20.
Okay, what would you say describe a Danish coach?
That's very different. There's a lot of types, I think.
Yeah.
There's some who is thinking more systems and like that everything is going like this, boom, 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 and we know exactly what we do. And then there's Jesper, for example, who is also like systems, but he also wants us to look at the situation and in the situation think, okay, what is best now? Is it best that I go and play or I stay back and go? So. There's a lot of different kinds of, and I have tried both types.
Okay. Would you say that Danish coach is getting loud?
Some. Not everybody.
Not everybody.
No.
Okay. Would you say that when you compare to the Russian or to the Angola thing coaches, what would you say are, I don't know, the best things? I would say, you know, structure was one thing, or the technical. What would you say need Danish coaches more? What did they need more?
And
first of all, you're one of the best nations in the world. So on both the stress, just yeah. when we talk about 99%, we want to go to 100%.
Yeah, exactly. Just
on this level.
Yeah, I understand. Maybe a bit more creativity. Actually, I think Jesper have it, but I think there is a tendency to go to the safe things and stick to them. And you also win a lot of games in that. But I think that it could be fun to, you know, then we do a VIP or then we do something else just to make the defense insecure to what we are doing. So they can't just watch video and say they do like this and this and this, and then we just try to keep him from doing it. But that there's a bit more unexpected things. That maybe is something the Danish culture could use.
Okay, that's interesting. I could imagine when you say everyone got the structure or really clear focus on each tactical movement, then everyone knows and plays the same tactical movements, everyone trains the same situation, and then is it often that some in the league, they often repeat? Did Jesper often talk the same when you play against other Danish teams here?
Yeah, we often do. We actually have two systems that we do every single time. Then we have, you know, small things that we do different from time to time, but it's very much the same, and we are succeeding with it. So that's very good, but I also think it's good when you just have something special that you just can do like this, and the defense is just, wow, where did that come from? So that's one thing I think it could be fun too.
Okay. You say you have an education like a physiotherapist, but you are right now a little professional handball player.
Yes.
So did you work beside handball?
Not now. I was thinking to do. I just finished my education this summer.
Okay.
So I just finished. Thank you. I was thinking to get some hours in a clinic in Esbjerg, but right now there's no time for it. With all the Champions League and the league in Denmark, and there's too much games to do something. So I will start to work, but not now.
Okay. Well, did you have a wish to go abroad?
Yeah.
Where?
Well, Hungary or France, that's my, I think, two top countries to go to. And I also once I thought about Russia, but that's a long way to Russia. But I'm actually pretty open. If there comes an offer from a team I think could be fun to play for, I could consider.
Okay, great. Mette, did you have any experience, any story you'd like to change which describe the Danish handball? Sometimes when you, I don't know, think back when you're younger and think about every one of my class was playing handball and we got a huge connection, so everyone was into sport, something like that. Did you have any story for us?
I think I don't have a specific story, but what I've learned from all my years in handball is that the friends I have who's not played a team sport, they are missing something. I think that you get so much from playing handball because you are in a team, you have to cooperate with your teammates, and in Denmark you really appreciate it. I think there's a lot of parents out there who want their children to go to football, handball, a team sport, to get that feeling that you are doing something for a greater good. You know, it's like you're doing this together, and I think that's why it's important for the Danish parents to get their children to a sport like handball, because you can get so big experience from so little. It's just a ball, two goals, a court, then you're there and you have these great experiences. So I think handball is really, really a good place to do something together and just make good stories.
Mette, Jason, mange tak.
Det var så lidt.
Goodbye.
Goodbye.